So I continue with the lectures on partial hyperbolicity. Today it's quite independent from yesterday. So I talk about invariant manifolds. So this morning it's more about existence, and in the afternoon about smoothness. On Monday, I said that for uniformly hyperbolic set, any point has a stable manifold and an unstable manifold. So here, we are partially hyperbolic. And we have, let's assume, a stable direction. And in this case, you may find a stable manifold. But since you may have several stable directions, several stable dimensions, you may look to stronger or weaker spaces. So you have different notions in principle of stable manifold. So we call this rather strong stable manifold. So here, F is a CK diffeomorphism. K is an invariant compact set. And we consider a partial hyperbolicity. We are interested by a stable direction. So I don't care about the unstable. I put it inside the center if there is. And so remember, to control this direction, there are some cones. So here, there is a cone contracted by F, and here a dual cone contracted by F minus 1. And now let's try to see what happens along this direction. So I pick epsilon small, very small, and the point x in k, and I want to look to those points which have the same feature as x, so which whose orbit goes close to the orbit of x, at the same speed as a contraction along s. So this is what I call the strong stable set. And it's defined, so for the point x, at the set of point y, such that for any n, the distance between the forward iterate of x and y are contracted like what happens along along ES, but there is a domination, so the contraction along ES is better than along EC, so one can require just that the contraction is stronger than what happens along EC. So the weakest contraction along EC is the minimal norm. And here I put some gap, so E minus N epsilon. And I want global manifold, so maybe the point Y will take a long time to come close to the orbit of X. So here, there is a constant, which depends on this point. Yes. Okay. So since there is a constant here, it does not depend on the metric. There is an invariance. What else? And as I said, if we consider a difference splitting, splitting with different dimensions, one could get, in principle, a different notion of strong stable manifold. Set, strong stable set. Okay, so the results now, like in the uniformly hyperbolic case, so it's due to Hirsch-Plouchoum, is that this set, in fact, is a manifold. So is an immersed, injectively immersed submanifold of class CK. So same K as for the diffeomorphism. There was a choice in the definition, this epsilon here, but it does not depend on epsilon if epsilon is small. If you take two such manifolds, if they intersect, they coincide. So are disjoint or coincide, and if you change the point, the manifold moves continuously. So to say that, look, it's a global manifold. So look to a local part. So look to the ball of radius eta in the stable manifold of X. So this is a disk. And then it varies continuously with the point X. So continuously for a topology here, which is a CK topology. Okay. So very similar to the stable manifold for the usual hyperbolic set. But you could say now, okay, but we have another bundle. What happens along this bundle? Do we have also an invariant manifold tangent to this bundle? Yes, here I didn't say it's tangent to E, EX. So we have a weaker result, which is a Plaque family theorem. So now I want to discuss the case of a bundle which is not contracted or expanded. So it's enough to take just a dominated splitting. And I will again discuss the bundle E, but you may apply it to F or to EC here. And here, there is no difference between C1 or CK diffeomorphism. So I just take a C1. And the Plaque family theorem, again by Hirsch-Plouchoum. Why SS? Well, it's what I'm used to do, but so the SS is to stress on the fact that there could be several candidates for a stable manifold. But you could say the same for the bundle, right? No, there is one reason that it's because sometimes I could define in general, just for topological dynamics, you may define the stable set as the set of point y such that the distance between the orbit of x and the orbit of y goes to zero. It's always defined. It's a set in general. Okay. But, well, it's just a choice of notation, but you should not be worried with that. Okay, so the Blake family theorem says there is something even without contraction or expansion, but just local. So for any, it says for any point in K, there is an embedding of the unit ball inside the space EX to M. So this map, let's call it DX. The image is a disk in the manifold M, such that so DX is centered at X, so it sends 0 to X. It's tangent, the image is tangent to EX. Then, so DX depends continuously on X for again for the so here for the C1 topology. Well, I didn't precise. It also depends continuously with a diffeomorphism, meaning that if you consider a diffeomorphism close and a set close, it has also a dominated splitting. There will be a plaque or a strong manifold for the point in this set, which are close to those of F. And the last part is about the invariance. There is only a local invariance. So it tells there is delta, such that if you just look to the plaque in restriction to the ball of radius delta, then when you iterate once, it's contained in the plaque at the image of the whole plaque. But if you continue to iterate, the point in this ball may start to escape from the plaque, so come close to the boundary, and then you lose control. So here, when you don't have contraction, here, this plaque family is not uniquely defined. In general, not unique. It's not C2 even if F is smooth. It's not invariant. Only locally invariant. The plaques are not coherent, meaning that dx union dy for xy close is not a submanifold. Dx is a submanifold, dy also, but they could intersect like that. And if you have such a splitting on the whole manifold, you may find plaque at any point. But in this case, dx is tangent to E only at x. Whereas for the strong stable, it's tangent at E at any point where E is defined. So I like to explain. So this theorem B implies theorem A. So I like to explain that and to show how to recover the good property, the invariance, the coherence, for instance, and the global definition, because here it's local. But only discussing the C1 topology here, because the plaque, for the moment, are only C1. So for C1. Okay. So how to get the strong stable manifold? What is a candidate from the plaque? Well, the plaque is, in principle, a piece of the strong stable manifold. Maybe just a part. Huh? A part, the center of the plaque is good. The boundary, we lose control. So we pick a small constant, eta, and we consider the plaque restricted to the ball of radius eta. And this, by definition, here will be the strong local, the local strong stable manifold of the point x. So it's a disk which has some these properties. And now we know that, so this is a disk almost tangent everywhere to E, which is ES now, which is contracted. And using that E is contracted, we want to say that this disk now is contracted. So take N large, and now any N larger than N, and look to the iterate. So if you look to the diameter, so this set is in a plaque. When you iterate, while it remains small, it's contained in the plaque because of local invariance. So if you can show the diameter is small, you can prove it's contained in the plaque. Huh? And since it is in the plaque is almost tangent to ES, it's in a cone in the direction ES, where you have a contraction, and so you can show the diameter is small. You lose something, but then it behaves like the tangent map along the direction ES. But I put a product of norm. So. So we don't know, but we know it is tangent to EX at the point X. So if you look to a small ball in the plaque, on this small ball, you almost tangent to E. If you look to point in a larger ball, you don't know. So this is one other reason why we take eta small. So before iterating, we know here we are almost tangent to ES. And then no. But this then these two properties are proved inductively. Huh? So let's assume you have this for some n. This one tells you that this iterate is very small. and contained in the plaque. So it's tangent to ES for the iterate. So you can iterate once more. And you iterate once more, the contraction is controlled by what happens along ES, and so you have a good contraction, and for the next iterate, you know that the diameter is still small, and so the local invariants tell you are still in the plaque. So you have to check that by induction, and the both at the same time. And now, since you're in the plaque and the diameter becomes very small, n is large enough, then in particular it's smaller than eta, and so the iterate of the strong of the local strong stable manifold are contained in the local strong stable manifold of the image. Okay, so and you see the way it shrink, how much it shrink, it's this quantity. I erase the definition of the strong stable set, but the strong stable set is a set of points which converge to the orbit of X better than the minimal norm along F, which is by domination, this one is stronger. So what we conclude is that the strong stable, the local strong stable manifold is contained in the strong stable set. And so by invariance, you also have, you may now iterate this backward, this one is invariant, and so F you have this. And here the union is increasing because of this here. So this part here is an increased union of disk, larger and larger. So this is an injectively immersed submanifold, which satisfies this property. So what we have to check is the other inclusion. So here we have equality. The union is equal to the... So how to do that? This is another place where you use a lot that you're stable. And this is, well, I don't maybe detail all the property, but this is also a key point to show that the coherence when you're stable, which is not here. So what is the argument? So I like to call it the coherence argument. So you take a point in the strong stable set, and you have to show it is in this union. But up to iterate, you may assume that, so Z will converge to the orbit of X, so up to iterating, you may assume it is already closed. So Fn of Z eta, if you want, for any n positive. So here you are, you have X, you have this plaque, this strong, local strong stable manifold, and you have another point satisfying the first definition I gave, and you want to show that it's inside. So if you don't know that, you may project, so take Y in the strong stable plaque, such that Z and Y are connected by an arc gamma. Z to Y, and is tangent, well, to the cone in the transverse direction, so it's C, tangent to C. And then you iterate forward. So what happens for gamma? Gamma is tangent to C, so remain tangent to C because the cone is contracted. And when you iterate forward, x and y get closer, z and x get closer, so z and y remain small, remain at a small distance. So gamma remains small. So remains tangent to c and small in the future. Okay, so now you may compute the speed of the contraction when you iterate forward. It's not contracted too much because it's tangent to this cone C, which is controlled by the direction EC, or F. So the length of Fn of gamma is larger than so some C E minus N epsilon times the minimal norm along ici. But on the other hand, you may look to this length here and this length here. So this length well, you know, it's just this estimate here. So, but then you may use a domination. The domination tells that what happens along ES is dominated by that with some, so let's say we have some gap. Then you have the factor given by the domination. And then you have this quantity. By domination. And along this direction, this is the definition of the strong stable set. So you contract like no more than this up to some loss here, some gap. And then, yes, how was it? I put this in the definition. Okay, so here I can be more careful and put 1/2. So this is by definition. And now you have the triangular inequality, which says that this one cannot be too large in comparison to this one, but this one are, so yeah, yes, are much smaller than this one. Huh? Okay. Okay. So now let's prove the Plaque family theorem, which is maybe less classical. And that gives some information also in the center. Sorry? Yes. Yes. This curve gamma, well, when maybe doesn't grow really, but if you compare to this length, well, let's assume it grow. But it remains tangent to C, so the geometry is bounded. Okay. So the distance between this point is controlled by the length of gamma. And then you have these two lengths here are much smaller than this one. So this is a contradiction. C is a cone, a vertical cone, a cone in the direction of EC. EC is a transverse direction. Okay? You're not satisfied. Bon, I continue and we can talk, okay? So let's, I don't know where I am, three. So proof of the Plaque family. So the proof is a graph transform argument. So the first idea is to lift the dynamic to the tangent bundle. So we have K with the dynamics. Is restricted to K, but then you look to the tangent bundle over K. So you have a projection. And here you have the tangent map. But you may also lift the dynamics of F in the manifold M as a map F hat, which is C1 close to DF. So how to do that? So f hat of x goes from the tangent space at x to the tangent space at f of x. And it's defined by, so it's f that you lift by the exponential. When you're close to zero. And far from zero, you glue with df. So you glue. So it's C1 close to df. You may check that. And now in the fiber in TXM, you have the cone Cx or Cx, the dual cone, which is control the direction E. You take it as a constant cone over the whole plane here, the whole space here. So it's contracted by df minus 1, but this map is closed, so also contracted. It's contracted inside the cone at the preimage of X by by the map you have defined, F hat. So now what we want is to find some manifold tangent to E. So you consider some candidate to be your manifold, so the space of Lipschitz graph. So Lx is a collection of graphs of maps psi from Ex to Fx. That goes through zero, and that such that the graph are tangent. So here the cone C star is here, tangent to C star. Okay, and this space, so it's a space of Lipschitz map. And you may define a distance. So it's the supremum. So you look, if you have two graphs, you want to look to the C0 distance. But in principle, the graph may separate, so you have to normalize by how far you look at the distance. Since it's Lipschitz, it converges. And so this space is complete. And then you iterate by F hat. So you want a contraction, and so lemma F hat minus 1 of x sends the Lipschitz graph at F of x to inside the Lipschitz graph at x. Why so? So take a graph at Lipschitz graph at F of x. When you iterate by F minus 1, so you find something. But here your tangent to C star, and you contract. So what you find here is still tangent to the dual cone. And so you cannot have two points which projects. So F minus, so if gamma is a graph of psi, F hat minus 1 of x of gamma, tangent to C star, imply that it projects injectively to Ex. Then you have to show that it is surjective to show that it is a graph. So you have you have defined a map. You started from E at F of X, and you end at E of X. So here you take a vector, you take the point in the graph. Here it's psi. Then you iterate backwards, and then you project. So this map is continuous, injective. It's proper also because it's Lipschitz, it's proper. Proper, injective. So from RK to RK, so it is surjective. And so defines a graph. And we have already checked that it is tangent to C star, so it is in LX. Okay, so we have the invariance of the space. We need to check the contraction. Yes. So lemma 2. So, yes, this map. Contracts. So take two graphs in, or maybe, okay, you take an iterate. So take two graphs, and you want to show when you iterate by this map how much they are contracted. So you have gamma 1, gamma 2. And here, you want to measure how close they are. So you choose U, and you look here to the difference. Let's call the difference V. And so this is vertical. This is along F. And now you iterate forward this time. So since you have something along F, here you have something which is close to F. So it's almost vertical. So the projection here may be different, but they are not too much different. So let's do as if they are the same, U prime. And so as if the image here is really vertical. So the distance here between F minus, so Fn hat minus 1 of gamma 1 and gamma 2. So it's this distance normalized by the size of U. And here this is, this distance is a supremum, so it is larger than V prime over U prime. Okay, but now V prime is the image of V, so here it's larger than, how is it? Yes, the minimum of df along f, ici. And here, that's the norm of dfn along es. And now you have u over v, which is the distance between the gamma 1, I already said. So if I am fine, we have a contraction here. No. Yes. I'm not fine. I wrote the other way. So here I said V is mapped to V prime, so ici, yes. Okay, so this term now I'm not fine. Sorry. Somebody see what? Well, I don't see anymore. Sorry. I can complete later. It's just the domination which gives the contraction. So check this point. It's the domination. Contraction. Okay. So we have a contraction somewhere. So now, to conclude, so we consider the space of graphs, so L is we look to all the space of graph at the same time, and so you look to the product. And now you have the map F hat minus 1, which acts as a contraction for the supremum norm. So there is a fixed point. So you have a family of graph which is invariant by F hat, and then you project to the manifold by the exponential map. And since F hat coincides with the lift of F, they are locally invariant. And it remains to check one thing, that it is C1. So how do you say that? So you have a map F hat, which is C1 along the fiber. Along the fiber, you have a cone which is contracted, so you have a dominated splitting in the fiber. And it tells that there is everywhere, so there is a bundle along the cone C star, which is E hat, let's call it E hat, which is continuous in the fiber. And the graphs are tangent to the cone, but invariant, so they are tangent to any iterate of the cone, so to E hat also, and so they have a tangent space which varies continuously, so they are C1. Okay. So this ends the proof of the Blake family. Yes. So this afternoon I will talk about smoothness, but one more word about existence of invariant manifold. In the center, up to now, we have only obtained plaques, and that are only locally invariant. Sometimes it's useful to study local dynamics in the center direction. But sometimes one wants something more global. So what could we say about the existence, the possible existence of center foliation? So center manifold. So let's assume that we are globally partially hyperbolic. So over the whole manifold. And what we would like is to know if there are foliation tangent to C and maybe tangent to Vs plus EC or EC plus EU. If it's the case, we say that F is dynamically coherent if there are invariant foliation. So foliation means a collection of submanifold tangent to this, to some of this bundle, and that form a partition. Tangent to ECS or ECU. We don't say that they are unique. There is no reason. And in particular, when we intersect these two foliation, we get a center foliation, which is also invariant. So there are cases we can say it exists. So if you start with a product, take an Anosov time identity, which gives the center. So in this case, it exists. But what about a dynamics clause, if you perturb? So there is a theorem, again, by Hirsch-Pushub, which say that there is an open set of system of which are dynamically coherent. So what is the point here? If you start with a system which has a center foliation, so you have this center foliation. Let me just discuss about the center foliation. So this is for the Anosov time identity. When you perturb, you may perform a graph transform argument, which gives a continuation of each of those leaves. So there are continuation. So why we are not satisfied just by that? In principle, that because these leaves, as the plaque, may intersect. They cover everything, but maybe they do not define a foliation. So then there is a delicate point, which is to check the coherence. So it's another story I don't tell here. And a last thing. So it's, yes, there exists center foliation in some case, but in other case, no. So there is an example by Hertz and Wess. So again, an open set of partially hyperbolic diffeomorphism. Which are not dynamically coherent. And to give an idea to what happens here, globally, here also. So it's in T3. There is a torus, two torus, which is invariant. And the dynamics locally is like a strong contraction transversally, time nanos off. So you have your two torus. And so the strong stable manifold is direction is transverse, but you may look to ECS, which is a sum of ES plus EC. So it's two-dimensional. But in fact, you may check that this set itself is a hyperbolic set. So this is a stable. This one is a strong stable, but this one is a stable space as of the hyperbolic set. Because in A, in the torus, you have a stable direction, which is EC here. Okay. So you have two-dimensional stable manifold, which should be the center stable. And now you look to the center unstable. So here you see the strong contraction is transverse to the torus, which is invariant. So T0 is tangent. So what happens in this two-dimensional stable manifold? They cross the torus along. So let's do. You have, in a stable manifold, you have the strong stable. And you intersect the two torus as a curve. But you also intersect you also have the center unstable, which is a plane field, which intersect this plane, this surfaces, as a vector field, which so it can be taken smooth outside this line, and so you may see how it integrates. And you will land at T0. And you see with this picture, you may not have a center foliation. You don't have a smooth leaves here. So this is the obstruction. Okay, sorry for the computation. We have notes where it's done. Thank you.